أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم من همزه ونفخه ونفثه بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد all praises and thanks are due to Allah we praise him we seek his help and we beg for his forgiveness we seek Allah's refuge from our evil deeds whomever Allah guides cannot be led astray and whomever is led astray shall find none other than to guide him. I bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped but Allah alone, who has no partner, and I bear witness that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam is his slave and messenger. Today, inshallah, we continue with our presentations on the anecdotes of the prophets, where we discuss the story, biography, history, and even the virtues of Allah's messengers and prophets, peace and blessings be upon them. And if I can recall vividly, today is episode 6. In our previous episodes, we discussed about, in general, the position of Allah's prophets and messengers, peace and blessings be upon him. Then the story of Adam, then the stories of Idris, then that of Nuh, then that of Hud, then that of Saleh. And today, inshallah, we are going to discuss the anecdote and the story of Prophet Ibrahim, that is Prophet Abraham. May peace, mercy, and blessings of Allah be upon him and be upon all of them as well. So today is episode number 6 and is more on the story of our father and the father of all Allah's prophets that came after him, that is Prophet Abraham, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. Today the story is going to be very precise and concise because of the fact that the story of Abraham in the glorious Quran could require up to 10 or 11, 12 or 13 episodes. It is because of this, to give the summary of his biography in 30 minutes is one of the most difficult things to be done. However, I will just make an attempt to bring some important references in the Quran that will make us to appreciate the gist of the presentation. Firstly, according to the most popular view, Abraham, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, was born in Babylonia city, as we explained in with regards to some other prophets. The time he was born, he found out that his people were worshipping idols. Some were worshipping stars, moon, sun, and many Allah's creatures. And when he was born, Allah Ta'ala endowed him with what is called natural spiritual understanding. Even at his age, as a teenager, he was pondering and reflecting over the creation of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala and challenging his people about what they were worshipping at that time, even before revelation came to him. And if you go through lineage, you will discover that his origin is back to Prophet Nuh, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. And at the same time, you will see sharing the same lineage with Prophet Saleh, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him as well. Abraham, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, his name, making reference to him, has been repeated 69 times in the glorious Quran. This is a clear justification that it is absolutely difficult to discuss all this within 30 minutes. If you compare the total number with the prophets we earlier discussed, you will discover that his story has been repeated many times, starting with Adam, who has been repeated 25 times, then Idris only 2 times, then Nuh 43 times, then Prophet Hud 7 times, then we came back to Prophet Saleh 9 times, and Prophet Abraham 69 times. So this tells you that his story has been repeated in the Quran in so many places. For example, if you look at Surah Al-A'raf, if you go through Surah Hud, if you go through Surah Al-An'am again, if also you go through Surah Al-Hajj, in so many places Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala speaks about the biography, the story, and the calamities experienced by Prophet Abraham, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. And at the same time, there is a chapter in the Quran which has been named and entitled after him. That is Surah to Ibrahim, the chapter of Abraham. That chapter has 52 verses. And this is another justification that his story has been repeated many times in the Quran. There is a chapter dedicated after Ibrahim, and the same with Nuh, as we explained earlier, Surah to Nuh, and the same with Hud, Surah to Hud, and there is chapter Surah to Ibrahim, which has 52 verses. Furthermore, in summary, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala tells us in the Quran about childhood of Prophet Abraham, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. And he is not only a prophet, but rather a prophet and also a messenger, as we explained earlier. And I hope we are going to explain that further in our presentation today. So he's a prophet, that is, was a prophet of Allah and also Allah's messenger. Bima'ana huwa nabiyun wa rasulun. And we explained the difference between prophets on one hand and messengers on the other. May peace and blessings of Allah be upon them all. So when Ibrahim was growing up, he discovered that his father was creating and constructing idols. Idols from stones and from wood. So he was worried. He was contemplating about what his father was doing. Once he engaged his father directly by asking him, what are you doing? And his father told him that I'm busy constructing idols. He said, for what? He said, for me to worship and for other people to also buy and worship. So he was flabbergasted and worried, thinking that how can someone create something, construct it, and at the same time worship it? It doesn't make sense. You are the one who constructs it, and you are going to worship it. Then it doesn't make sense. Because whatever you construct is supposed to be your servant. But in a situation where you do it and at the same time you worship it, he said it doesn't make sense to him. So he engaged his father, and whenever his father goes out, Abraham used to go and sit down on one of them, like punishing him the way we climb over maybe anything, like even donkey. So it's in the same way. And his father was discouraging him from doing that. And he was engaging his father through argument that, no. Dad, what you have been doing doesn't make sense to me. Why? Because even at tender age, Abraham, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, had been endowed with natural spiritual understanding. And that is why you will discover his position Islamically, and even in Old Testament and in New Testament, you will discover that his position has been elevated. Why? Because of that natural spiritual understanding that he had been endowed with even before he became a prophet and messenger of Allah, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. And this is what the Quran draws our attention to, like in Surah Al-Anbiya, verse 51, where Allah says, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا إِبْرَاهِيمَ رُشْدَهُ. Indeed, we have given Ibrahim his own portion of guidance. Allah Ta'ala has given him a portion of guidance before the first revelation came to him. And that is why you will discover, because of that position, that prestigious position of Abraham, in so many places in the glorious Quran, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala drew our attention to his position. And there are many things today you see in the world that are going back to Abraham. For example, our Eid al-Adha, where we usually sacrifice our sacrificial animal. We slaughter animals on the 10th of Zulhijjah of each and every year during our festival. That was reference to the sacrifice of Abraham when he had been directed to slaughter his son Ismail. And at the time he was planning to slaughter him, Allah Ta'ala sent a sacrificial animal for him, substituting Ismail with that animal. So the animals we slaughter today during our Eid al-Adha on 10th of Zulhijjah of each and every year is going back to the sacrifice of our father Abraham, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. And secondly, don't forget, we pray 5 daily prayers every day, Zuhur, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, Subuh. And always our direction, our Qibla, where we face to pray is Kaaba, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Mecca, which arguably be the center of the world. Where we face, through history, Abraham, along with his son Ismail, constructed and built Kaaba, or rebuilt and reconstituted and reconstructed Kaaba. So it is another indication that we will never forget with Prophet Abraham, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. Why? Because whenever you face Kaaba, don't forget who built that Kaaba. Our father Abraham alayhi salam, as in Surah Al-Baqarah, which I hope it will be explained in our subsequent discussions. So this is his position. Allah Ta'ala endowed him, blessed him with a portion of guidance since during his own tender age. And he was challenging his parents that were worshipping idols, challenging elders politely and wisely why they were worshipping idols. Some at that time were worshipping stars, some worshipping sun, some worshipping moon, and some worshipping idols from stone or wood. But Abraham alone was challenging them day in, day out. That has been his own tradition and his approach to issues. And finally, he also engaged his father before the first revelation came to him. And this is what has been narrated even in Surah Al-An'am. For example, if you go through Surah Al-An'am starting from verse 74, 75, 76, 77, 78, 79, 80, 81, 82, 83, you will discover that Abraham engaged his father by inviting him to look into what he has been worshipping critically, and at the same time reflecting, pondering over what his people used to do of worshipping stars, moon and sun. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ لِأَبِيهِ آزَرَ أَتَتَّخِذُ أَصْنَامًا آلِهَةً إِنِّي أَرَاكَ وَقَوْمَكَ فِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ وَكَذَلِكَ نُرِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ مَلَكُوتَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لِيَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُوقِنِينَ. Allah Ta'ala says to us, remember the time that Abraham said to his father Azara, Atattakhidhu asnaman aliha, why do you consider asnaman, idols, aliha, as your Lord? Inni araka, O daddy, I see you with your people in a very clear, manifest arrow. So he challenged them. He was talking to his father at least politely and wisely, drawing his attention to what they used to do. And Allah says, وَكَذَلِكَ نُرِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ مَلَكُوتَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. It is in the same way we show to Abraham the kingdom of the heavens and the earth, so that he will be among those who have faith with certainty in that faith. And Allah says, فَلَمَّا جَنَّ عَلَيْهِ اللَّيْلِ. Abraham one night left his house and moved away, looking at the sky, looking at the stars, the moon. He was contemplating why people are busy worshiping this. And looking at their position, he was contemplating whether to be like them or not. فَلَمَّا جَنَّ عَلَيْهِ اللَّيْلُ رَآ كَوْكَبًا قَالَ هَذَا رَبِّي. When the night covered, رَآ كَوْكَبًا, at the night, he looked at skies and said, so is this a lot? فَلَمَّا أَفَلَ قَالَ لَا أُحِبُّ الْآفِلِينَ. Then later on, it disappeared. In the morning, he couldn't see anything. And he said, no. How can someone worship God that disappears? God that has not been consistent. And the same happened with even the sun. When he looked at sun, he said, no, this is a bigger one. And at night, when the sun disappeared, he said, no, I cannot worship that. And to the end where he said, inni wajjahtu wajhiya lilladhi fatara as-samawati wal ardi hanifan. So Abraham was contemplating, challenging his people, and he partook in critical thinking. Even before the first revelation came to him, he rejected what they were worshiping. And later on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed a message to him, and he started by engaging his father when a book was revealed to him. A revelation came to him, appointing him as Allah's prophet and messenger, and a book was revealed to him, and the name of the book has also been mentioned even in Surah Al-A'la, the last verse. So for Ibrahim or Musa, or let me say verse 19, that is the scripture of Abraham and Moses. Allah Ta'ala mentions their own book in the same verse of Surah Al-A'la, the last verse, verse 19. So Allah Ta'ala sent a revelation to him. And this is what the Quran even draws our attention to in so many places. For example, even in Surah Maryam, where Allah said to our Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him and all of us, وَذُكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ صِدِّيقًا نَبِيًّا إِذْ قَالَ لِأَبِيهِ يَا أَبَتِ لِمَ تَعْبُدُ مَا لَا يَسْمَعُ وَلَا يُبُصِرُ وَلَا يُغْنِي عَنْكَ شَيْئًا. Surah Maryam verse 41 and 42. He talked to his father politely. Allah says, وَذُكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ. Mentioned in the book, that is in the Quran, the story, the biography and the anecdote of Abraham, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. Innahu kana siddiqan nabiyya. And he was indeed a trustworthy prophet. Idh qala li abihi, remember when he said to his father, ya abati, oh my father, lima ta'abudu, why are you worshiping? Ma la yasma'u, something that cannot hear. وَلَا يُبُصِرُ, and cannot see. وَلَا يُغْنِي عَنْكَ شَيْئًا, and cannot in any way benefit you with anything. How can you worship something that cannot hear, cannot talk, cannot in any way benefit you with anything? So this is the beginning of his preaching, inviting people to believe in Islamic monotheism. And Ibrahim, peace be upon him, was very consistent, very steadfast, very energetic and very purposeful in what he used to do. And that is why, because of that perseverance and steadfastness and the strength of his faith, even all the prophets that came after Ibrahim, their lineage was going back to him. And this is what the Quran draws our attention to. For example, in some of the verses we discussed during our first lesson, that is verse 83, 84, 85, 86, where Quran says, وَتِلْكَ حُجَّتُنَا آتَيْنَاهَا إِبْرَاهِيمَ عَلَىٰ قَوْمِ نَرْفَعُ دَرَجَاتٍ مَنْ نَشَاءَ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ حَكِيمٌ عَلِيمٌ وَوَهَبْنَا لَهُ إِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ كُلًّا هَدَيْنَا ونوحا هدينا من قبل ومن ذريته داود وسليمان وأيوب ويوسف وموسى وهارون وكذلك نجزي المحسنين وزكريا ويحيى وعيسى وإلياس كل من الصالحين وإسماعيل واليسع ويونس ولوطا وكلا فضلنا على العالمين. So if you look at verse 83, وتلك حجتنا آتيناها إبراهيم. The verse begins with, this is our proof, our evidence we have given to Ibrahim. And finally, Allah mentions the name of the prophets and messengers that came after him. Why? Because they are on da'wah, inviting people to Allah's religion and their own approach, Islamic monotheism. And even their lineage was going back to, they were all going back to Abraham, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. So then Allah Ta'ala appointed him as a prophet and he commended him in so many places in the glorious Quran. Allah Ta'ala commended our father Ibrahim, peace be upon him, millat abikum Ibrahim, huwa samakum al-muslimina min qablu, wa fi hadha liyakuna rasul shahidan alaykum wa takunu shuhada ala nas, wa aqimu salata wa atu zakata wa tasimu billahi huwa mawlakum fa ni'mal mawla wa ni'man nasir. So in one of the places where Allah Ta'ala commends Prophet Abraham, for example, with so many qualities and virtues, is like Suratul Nahl, verse 120, 121, and even 122. Allah Ta'ala commends our father Abraham, peace be upon him, by saying, Inna Ibrahim kana ummatan kanita lillahi hanifan walam yaku minal mushrikina. Inna Ibrahim, verily Abraham, kana ummatan, he was a nation. Abraham alone was a nation, was a righteous leader, was an upright leader. Kanita lillahi hanifan, and he was hanifan. Hanifan meaning he was worshipping Allah alone, a worshiper of Allah alone and no more, no less. Walam yakun minal mushrikin, and he was not part of idolaters. Shakiran li an'ami, he was thankful to Allah for his favor. Ijtabahu, and he chose him, he selected him. Wahadahu, and guided him to the right path. Wa atainahu fi dunya hasana, in this world Allah said we gave him something that was good to him. Wa fil akhirah, and in the hereafter he will be rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that direction. So this is where Allah Ta'ala explains to us some of the qualities and virtues of our father Abraham in Suratul Nahl, verse 120, 121 and 122, and even the last verse of Suratul Hajj. At that time Abraham engaged his people more by inviting them to Islam, by inviting them to the oneness of Allah. They were resisting and even challenging him, and he maintained that tempo of inviting them to Islam, to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And finally, the Quran draws our attention to his conversation with his people when he discovered that most of them were not willing to accept the message except his wife Sarah and his brother Lut. So at that time what happened? They planned to assassinate him after Abraham did a da'wah through his action by destroying most of their idols they were worshipping. And this is what the Quran draws our attention to, like in Suratul Anbiya, starting from verse 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 67, 68, 69, 70, 71, 72. This is what the Quran draws our attention to in these verses, up to and 72. For example, he came and destroyed all their idols that they were worshipping at that time. When they came, they discovered their gods, wal-iyadu billah, their idols were destroyed. And they said, قَالُوا مَنْ فَعَلَ هَذَا بِآلِهَتِنَا إِنَّهُ لَمِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ, as in Suratul Anbiya, verse 59. Who committed this atrocity to our idols, to our gods, as they said? He is definitely one of the wrongdoers. He is part of al-Zalimun. In the next verse, verse 60, Kalu Sami'ina Fatan Yadhkuruhum Yuqalu Lahu Ibrahim. In verse 60, they said, we have heard one young man by name Abraham criticizing and insulting our lords. in verse 61 they say qalu fa'atu bihi ala ayyina qalu in yaskutu qalu fa'atu bihi. They asked Ibrahim to be brought before them, and they asked him, qalu a anta fa'alta hadha bi alihatina ya Ibrahim, are you the one who committed this atrocity to our lords, to our gods, ya Ibrahim? And he replied by saying, bal fa'alahu kabiruhum hadha. No, ask the bigger one, because he did not destroy the bigger one. He destroyed all the remaining idols, leaving the bigger one. And he said, ask the bigger one. Fas'aluhum in kanu yantiqun. Ask him if at all they can talk. Ask him. He did not say, I'm not the one, but he said, ask him. So if he cannot talk, then that was the foundation of Abraham challenging them why they were worshiping something that couldn't talk, that couldn't in any way help them with anything. Fas'aluhum in kanu yantiqun. He challenged them to ask them if at all they can talk. Then finally, when they admitted that their idols couldn't talk, then he asked them, lima ta'budu ma la yasma'u? Why are you worshiping something that cannot hear, that cannot help you, that cannot do anything for you? And at the end, they asked their team to mobilize people so that they can burn, they can put Ibrahim on fire and kill him at all. And they brought Ibrahim, they at least arranged their own plan, they brought their own fire to destroy and kill Ibrahim along with those who believe in his message. And they threw Ibrahim into the fire. And Allah said to the fire, Qulna ya naru kuni bardan wa salaman ala Ibrahim. And Allah said to the fire, be bardan, just become cool, calm, wa salaman, and be a source of peace to Ibrahim. When they threw him into the fire, Allah Ta'ala directed the fire not to harm him in any way, and they were not successful. And Ibrahim spent a moment inside the fire, and Allah Ta'ala rescued him. And at the end of the verses, from 71, 72, Allah Ta'ala rescued him. وَنَجَّيْنَاهُ وَلُوطًا إِلَى الْأَرْضِ الَّتِي بَارَكْنَا فِيهَا. Allah rescued him along with his brother Lut. Then they were rescued from their people. So the message we are going to learn from this is, if you are steadfast in doing what is right, you are consistent, be rest assured that Almighty Allah will always protect you. Whenever you are confronted with challenges, calamities, and afflictions, don't forget that Allah Ta'ala is always there for you. And from there, Allah Ta'ala blessed Ibrahim with Ismail and Ishaq. And our Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, if you go through his lineage, was from the family of Ismail. And if you go through the lineage of Ishaq, you will discover that Prophet Yaqub is from that lineage, and even Prophet Joseph, Prophet Yusuf, from that lineage as well. So this is how Allah Ta'ala blessed his own family, as he promised in the glorious Quran, with so many prophets and messengers. Not only prophets and messengers, but some of them are among the Ulul Azmi, first class category of prophets and messengers, which that category includes Nuh, Ibrahim, Musa, Isa, and Muhammad, peace and blessings of Allah be upon them all. And this is how Allah Ta'ala rescued our father Abraham, peace be upon him. That is why in so many traditions you will discover our prophet used to make reference to Abraham, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, by saying he was his father. And it is the same Quran draws our attention to that, that the path of Islam is the path of our father Ibrahim alayhi salam. He has named and entitled us as Muslims, those who submit themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah give us the ability to continue to emulate his teachings, consistency, constancy, and steadfastness. May Allah Ta'ala endow us with a tawheed of Islamic monotheism so that we can persevere any challenge. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka atubu ilayk. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim, wa barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim, إنك حميد مجيد. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته، والله تعالى أعلم.